What's up, guys? Welcome to Daily Dose of Reddit. This is your host, Zach, and today's subreddit is r/entitledparents.
This story is called Entitled Karen Wrecks My New PC. I'm back again, mother fathers. So, backstory. I just got a new PC for my birthday, as I've been saving up for about 6 months, and my dad gave me half of the money to put towards it. When this happens, I was halfway through building it. Now, on to the cast. Oh, also, I don't like small kids, like, at all. Also, sorry how long it is, I can't do short. Seems you can't do grammar or punctuation either. I'm just kidding. Here's the cast. There's me, a 15-year-old gamer boy.
6-year-old entitled nephew.
24-year-old entitled stepsister.
Dad. Ben, friend one.
Tyler, friend two.
I go downstairs to get some more water because my room was a gosh darn sauna, and this is where the story all starts.
Can entitled nephew play in your room?
Not now, I am building my new computer.
You shouldn't be up in your room hiding, people are up for your birthday.
Okay, I see your point, but I told people that were coming up that I would be down later because I have friends up and I was gonna build my PC.
Okay, whatever.
Yeah, whatever.
I go upstairs with my bottle of water and entitled nephew is in my room. I'm kind of angry. Can you get out of my room?
No, my mom.
British spelling, mother father.
Said I can.
Well, it is my room, so can you please leave?
Fine.
He goes into a huff.
You could have let him stay.
I don't really trust him around my old PC, never mind my new mid-build PC.
I agree. I don't even trust my 14-year-old cousin near mine.
We go back to building the PC. Then entitled sister enters.
Why did you throw entitled nephew out of your room?
Because I am building my new PC and I don't want him to put his sticky hands on my new parts.
His hands aren't sticky and he won't ruin any of your parts.
I mean, he is like 5. Kids that young, hands are always sticky.
Tyler, who even asked you to be here?
I did, because they are my friends and are helping me build the PC.
Well, entitled nephew can be in this room.
No, he can't. It's my room and I put money to the house, so I practically pay for my room. And you can't boss me about because you moved out.
So I'm older than you, you'll do what I say.
Ben and Tyler start laughing and entitled sister leaves and gets my dad.
Let entitled nephew in your room or you'll be on double chores.
Okay, but if he breaks anything, she's paying for it.
What? No, if he breaks anything, it's your fault.
No, it's not. It's your kid, your responsibility.
Okay, if he breaks anything, she'll pay.
Okay. Entitled sister and dad leave the room and entitled nephew enters.
So what are you doing?
We are building my new PC.
What's a PC?
Me, starting to get annoyed. It's a computer.
Like an Xbox?
Yes, but a lot better.
Nothing's better than an Xbox.
Me, Ben, and Tyler start laughing. That's your opinion.
What do you think's better?
PC, can you stop asking questions? He was starting to annoy me.
I'm bored.
I don't care. Tell your mom.
No, I don't want to.
What do you want me to do?
Put the TV on for me.
Nah, we're listening to music. Why are you crying? Entitled nephew goes downstairs, gets entitled sister. Entitled sister comes upstairs with entitled nephew. Ben and Tyler both wish me luck. Entitled sister starts screaming and shouting.
What are you shouting about? I told him he couldn't watch the TV because I only have Netflix and we are listening to music. He's gonna stay in here.
Okay. Entitled sister leaves and entitled nephew comes back in.
Put the TV on for me.
No, and don't go near my PC. At this point, Ben and Tyler are just messing about, not really helping with the PC. Entitled nephew walks to the PC.
Wow, why are the colors changing in there?
Because they're RGB lighting.
What's RGB?
It's a type of lighting that can change colors.
Ooh!
It's cool, yeah?
Yeah!
Entitled nephew steps on my new RTX 2080, breaking it.
What the frick, tech entitled nephew? I said don't go near my PC or parts! And you freaking broke it!
I said this pretty loud. At the same time, the music downstairs and in my room is changing. Entitled sister runs upstairs. Entitled nephew is now crying.
Why is entitled nephew crying?
He stood on my part and broke it, and I shouted at him.
Entitled sister tries to hit me as my dad comes in the room.
What the frick tank are you doing?
He grabs her and throws her and entitled nephew out of the room and asks me what happened, and I told him.
He was not happy and told Entitled Sister that she owed me the £1,149, and she paid up. The end. Okay, yeah, that sucks and everything, but at least she paid for it, okay? Let me know in the comments below anytime you've had a little kid break something very valuable of yours. I remember my little brother spilled his Pediasure all over my PSP, so that was horrible. I haven't talked to him since. This story's called Entitled Mom Insists That the Rules Don't Apply Since She Paid to Attend a LARP. So I've talked a lot about my time LARPing, live action roleplaying. Think improv acting meets D&D if you aren't familiar. From me, you've probably read about entitled parents at Ren Fairs, entitled moms trying to force their children on us mid-LARP, and entitled moms trying to get a better role for their children in a LARP. Hey, we read that one. Now, we get to an entitled mom in a LARP. The story starts off quite sweet. The LARP organizing company I worked for at the time was running a light horror weekend game. A game runs Friday to Sunday that revolved around a group of people who are locked in a biological warfare lab and have to work together to escape. A member of the local college role-playing society, where we get most of our players from, booked two places. Apparently, she and her mom LARPed a lot back home, and having enjoyed some of our previous events, she wanted to gift her mom a place on our next event for her birthday. As I said, it's very sweet. The event rolls around without incident and starts as normal. The players arrive at the venue, in this case a fairly remote retreat center, and once everyone has arrived and put their bags in their assigned bunks, we sit everyone down to go through all the pre-game necessities. This includes the safety briefing, the system briefing, i.e. how to play the game, and then the need to know stuff for time in, the start of the game. As will become very important later, this included the note that all belongings the players had brought, clothes, personal items, were OOC, out of character. We had told people to pack light. I believe the exact wording in the event brief sent out to players months and then again weeks in advance was, "You'll only need basic clothes to wear under in-game props and essentials like toiletries." This was because, in-game, the players would all wake up naked. They would be wearing clothes but have to act like everyone is naked, before being provided with boiler suits as part of the game. As a basic TLDR for that, any items the players had brought with them were not considered to be part of the game. Now, the big crux of this game was that the facility was full of these gnarly living vine creatures, achieved via refs and a few non-player character actors dressed in modified bodysuits and masks, who, after learning about the presence of the players, would slowly try to kill them over the course of the weekend. In a twist that sort of deviated from the normal run of LARP, we actually scheduled the first encounter of the creatures fairly early in the game. The refs would radio in around 10 p.m. on Friday night if they had 1 to 2 players fairly isolated, and then we'd have 2 of the monsters basically jump scare them. This would not only introduce the element of there's something else here, but it would also sow suspicions between the players that saw the creatures and the ones that didn't. So 10:30 Friday night rolls around and I radio in. Our mother-daughter pair, who are playing mother-daughter in-game by request, are all alone in the generator room. I call time freeze on my room, a ref command to pause the game, and have the players close their eyes. I get the monsters hidden and then unfreeze the game. Mother-daughter continue to search until one of the monsters pops out behind the daughter, grabs her, and calls Entangle, a monster command specially for this game which held the player in place and didn't allow them to move their arms or anything. The mom screams, runs over, and pulls out a LARP-safe knife, and starts LARP stabbing the monster. LARP weapons are typically hard form with a Kevlar core, since actually putting pressure on the tip of a LARP weapon could force the core to come out and actually create a dangerous point. LARP stabs are stopped before contact, and then the damage of the attack is called by the player. Here's the cast. There's me, entitled mother, embarrassed daughter,
other ref.
Whoa, time freeze, time freeze. What's wrong? Oh no, did I actually get them with the knife? Oh, I'm sorry. No, it's the knife that's the problem. Where did you get it from? Oh, I brought it with me from home.
But remember in the briefing when we said that nothing you brought with you counted in the game?
Yeah, but I figured that we could just say that I found it while I was searching and that I'd actually have the prop.
Has a ref told you at any point that you found a knife?
Well, no, but it's such a small thing. It's not going to derail the game if I have one little knife.
Spoiler alert, in a game like this, a person with a knife on the first night would 100% ruin the game. And that was why we didn't have any knife props in any of the places the players could access on the first night. Okay, what we're gonna do is just rewind the scene a little. I'll take the knife and we'll just go from when the monster grabbed Embarrassed Daughter.
I'm not giving you the knife.
Entitled Mom, you can't have a knife that just spontaneously appeared.
I paid to be here, so I should get to dictate the direction of my experience.
Mom, you promised you wouldn't do this.
I'm sorry, dear, but you know how I feel when the people running the game micromanage everything and ruin everyone's fun. Me having a little knife and only being able to do one damage every few seconds is not gonna ruin the game.
Spoiler alert, yes, it would. Here's my problem. I can't really explain to her how the presence of a weapon in the player party drastically shifts the balance of power in the early stages of the game and undermines the tense, helpless atmosphere we were trying to achieve. So I called in some backup. Into my radio.
Hey, I have a bit of a situation down here. Little help, please.
After a minute or so, other ref comes down and I go to meet them at the door to the room.
What's up?
Entitled Mom brought a prop knife in with her and is insisting that I just let her have it because in her mind, it would be inconsequential.
Did you explain that she just can't have a knife?
Yep.
Alright, I got this.
Other ref approaches Entitled Mom and Embarrassed Daughter.
Entitled Mom, you can't have a knife that wasn't cleared by a member of the ref team. Plus, you didn't declare your knife, so we haven't been able to confirm whether it's LARP safe or not. We have to weapon check all the props, especially if a player is bringing it in. Give us a knife, and if you find one in character, you can use your prop.
No, why don't you people understand? It doesn't matter if my character has a knife, it's such a small thing. It's not like it's going to kill one of these monsters right away or anything.
Entitled Mom, your character woke up naked with no possessions, and since then, you haven't found a knife or anything similar. You don't have a knife in character. Now, you could either give us the knife, or we take you out of the game.
Well then, you'll have to take my daughter out of the game too, because if I go, she goes.
No, I want to keep playing. Mom, just give them the knife.
You could always come and pick up your daughter on Sunday, or we could have someone drive her home at the end of the game.
No, I get to keep the knife or we're both going home.
Other ref radios for a game-wide time freeze at this point and calls all the refs down to the generator room.
Oh, so now you're ganging up on me?
No, I want more witnesses.
The other refs arrive. The ref team totals 5, plus 2 non-player character actors.
Entitled Mom, you are breaking LARP rules and now you are holding up the game for everyone else. So, you either hand over your knife or you leave. At this point, you will be escorted from the premises, and if you continue to resist, we will call the police.
Oh, very mature. Fine, I'll hand over the freaking knife. But this is all stupid. Flippin' stingy illegitimate childs. Guess no one can have fun unless it's by your rules.
Another ref to me.
You got this?
Yeah, I'll finish up the scene. The refs leave, and a few moments later, the game resumes. Alright, he added some frequently asked questions and we'll go through them. So what happened next? The rest of the game ran without incident. Entitled Mom pretty much sulked throughout the rest of the weekend and spent most of the game either in her bunk reading or just sort of moped on the edge of big group scenes. What did Embarrassed Daughter mean by Entitled Mom promised not to do this? A few weeks after the event, I was hanging out with Embarrassed Daughter and she apologized for her mom and explained that her mom had a tendency to square off with LARP refs who wouldn't just let her have her carte blanche in regards to her characters. This wasn't raised prior to the game because A, Embarrassed Daughter didn't want to throw shade at her mom, and B, her mom had apparently promised to keep herself in check. What was the big deal with Entitled Mom having a knife? Three things. First of all, it just went against the premise of the game and put Entitled Mom at an unfair advantage. Second, it's important to have LARP boundaries. If players can just will items into existence, what's to stop a player from saying, "Oh, now I have a machine gun"? Furthermore, players can't find an item without a ref telling them that they have found an item. That's just common sense. Finally, if a player has a knife really early in the game, that diminishes the terror of being helpless against the monsters. It encourages the players to go on the attack from the beginning, and just generally derails the game. I really like these LARP stories because it amazes me how far these people go to ensure the immersion of the players. And, man, that just sounds so fun.
Seriously, LARPing like this and just playing D&D even, it all sounds so fun and I really want to try it. Also, the entitled mom in the story, what a jerk! She's ruining the game for everyone. I hate when people do that. When you're just trying to play a game and they're just like, oh, it's just a game. It's who cares? It doesn't matter. No, it does matter. Okay, rules matter. Without rules, society crumbles and we all die. Painful, fiery deaths because no rules, right? This story's called Real Life Karen Loses It at a Barbershop and Doesn't Understand Modern Technology. This happened this past weekend. I was in need of a haircut and decided to head out to my local national chain barbershop. As, like most people, I am not a fan of lines. I did online check-in to put myself in the queue before I drove to the barbershop. The shop does not take appointments, just online and walk-in check-ins. Upon arrival, I notice that I am first in the queue. While looking for my name on the digital board, I notice I am 4 or 5 down the list that said Karen plus 2. Being a fan of this board, I quietly snickered at this. The online check-ins have a symbol next to their name. Karen's did not, but everyone in front of her did. I sit down, and the only other person in the shop is a woman. Obviously, our literal Karen. Sadly, without the haircut. Would have been perfect. And her 3 kids. There were no barbers available. But after a minute or two, one became free, and as I was at the top of the queue, they called my name and I took my seat. As I moved to take my seat, Karen, in pure Karen voice and fashion, shouted at the barber, "Excuse me, I was here first. My children need haircuts, so I should go next." The barber informed Karen that the queue fills with people who do digital check-ins and walk-ins in the order they are received, and you don't need to be present to take your place in the queue via digital check-in. Karen huffed and puffed a bit, but eventually sat down in anticipation that she would be next. If that were the end of it, I probably wouldn't have bothered posting. But moments later, 2 of the remaining queue members who checked in digitally and were in front of Karen and her kids arrived and took their place. When the next barber called the digital queue member's name, Karen lost it and went on a full-scale rant. She ranted against modern technology, the lack of respect for working mothers, and the cherry on top, how the customer service has changed for the worse in a world full of millennials who are always on their phones, making their lives easier, like, you know, checking in at the barbershop to save time. Karen proceeded to take her shaggy-haired brood and left. I asked the barber cutting my hair if that happened frequently, and she said, "More than you'd think," with an eye roll. And that, my friends, is the story of how Karen's kids failed to receive a haircut because she doesn't understand technology. Man, Karens are impossible to please. They are presented with amazing technology that they are 100% able to use. Yet, when the technology is used, they have a fit. I would love to see them live in a world without this annoying millennial technology and see how happy they'd be then. Goodness. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit that bell to never miss an episode.